praise the living God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh yes, let us listen to this song in worship. Days of Elijah, our anniversary song. 2 weeks from today will be our Thanksgiving Sunday on the 13th of December 2020. Thank you, Lord. We worship you. We bless your holy name. We thank you for your kindness, your faithfulness, and all the good things you have done for us. We ask for your blessings this afternoon, Lord. Pour your blessings upon us. Pour your Holy Spirit upon us, Lord. Pour your grace upon us, Lord. We pray. Heal us. Break yokes and chains. Set us free from the plans of the evil one. Sing. And let your glory be upon us. This afternoon, bless your people in your word. Father, we pray. Have mercy. As we prepare to thank you, may you receive us graciously. And bless the nations. Let your kingdom come and help us. Thank you this afternoon. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. We bless your holy name. Thank you, Lord, this afternoon. We give you praise. Yeah, these are the days of your servant David. Oh, Lord, help us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Yes. We are the laborers in your kingdom, declaring the word of the Lord. He's riding on the cloud, shining like the sun. Oh, lift your voice. Indeed, it's a year of jubilee. May the Lord's grace be upon us. Hallelujah. And there is no one like Jehovah. Thank you. Bless us, oh Lord. There's no one like Jehovah. There's no one like Jehovah. There's no one like the Elohim. There's no one like him. He's a great, he's an awesome God. There's no one like Jehovah, the creator of the universe. His name is Almighty. Thank you, Lord. There is no one like Jehovah. There is no God like Jehovah. Thank you, Lord. There is no one like you. We worship you. We will serve you. We will obey you. And we have mercy on us. Our Lord Jesus comes. Hallelujah. Indeed, behold, he comes. Our Lord Jesus comes. We bless his holy name this very afternoon. So let's ask, I think we've prayed already, but let's ask the Lord to speak through his servant that the words that will come from him will be inspired by the Holy Spirit. And Lord, this is our prayer this afternoon as you give us your word, that indeed you speak through your servant. Inspire him to speak your very oracles and give your people the faith that they need to respond like Noah, like David, like Samson, like Abraham, like all the patriarchs and all the godly men and women who are with you now. So bless us in the name of Jesus. We pray, amen, amen, amen. So we thank God for his kindness, his goodness. Today is Sunday, the 29th of November, 2020. We are having our service online because of the lockdown restrictions. So we are preparing ourselves for our annual Thanksgiving service and also for our 15th anniversary celebrations. Our topic today is simple. Our thanksgiving to God is part of our redemption story. Our thanksgiving to God is part of our redemption story. So here we look at grace, redemption, thanksgiving, and new life. How the grace of God appears, and as we respond, we are redeemed from sin and its consequences. And that out of that, we thank God. And that God gives us a new life in covenantal terms. And so, in particular, we're focusing on the story of Noah, how God was so gracious to him, and how Noah responded, And when God redeemed him, you know, I thank God, and God gave him a new life for the rest of humanity. Our thanksgiving to God is part of our redemption story. If you don't really know your redemption story, then you don't have a very strong conviction to thank God yearly or regularly. And I will read this sentence to open the discussion by saying that our thanksgiving to God is part of a redemption story we experience because God's grace and mercy came to us. If you read Ephesians 1, 3 to 10, Paul was saying, let's praise God for all the spiritual blessings that he has lavished upon us in Christ Jesus. And one of the themes in there, in that passage, was that Christ has redeemed us from sin and he has cleansed us. And so then that story itself, there was an element of thanksgiving. And again, he did not fail to mention how Christ has redeemed we Christians. Now, what God redeemed you from, whatever God has redeemed you from, is your measure, your base, your reference point in life. Whatever God has redeemed you from is your base upon which you can have any meaningful discussion about life, your salvation. It is your reference point in life. I'll mention some example here. David was a rejected, despised young shepherd by his family, and God called him to become a king. So David, his reference point in life was always the shepherd boy who was neglected. And of course, we can talk about Abraham, who was from an idol worship background, and God called him from Genesis 12. He says, leave your kindred, the place you live, leave everything and go to a new place. And when Abraham responded, he became the father of faith. We can talk about Paul of Tarsus. Paul from Tarsus also was a persecutor of the church and a blasphemer, and he will always reference this point in all his personal testimony. To him, that was his basis of thanksgiving. And this very afternoon, I'm sure you also have a reference point, and if you have forgotten, I'm sure the Lord will remind you. The Israelites were slaves under Pharaoh, so that was their reference point. And anytime God will communicate with his people in the old covenant, he will remind them that, remember that you were slaves in Egypt, right? You were slaves in Egypt. And so if you don't know your reference point, then you will not have a strong conviction to thank the Lord, because our reference point is always part of our redemption story. And through that, we thank God for saving us. You see, sin and its effects put us in bondage in many ways. So there are some people, sin and its bondage has made them, how do you call it, addicted to substance use. Sin and its bondage has made them poverty. Some sin and its bondage has put some sicknesses, diseases upon their life. If you study the New Testament carefully, you realize that Christ will first forgive sins before people, you know, get healed. So sin can bring about sicknesses, it can bring about divorce, it can bring about barrenness, it can bring about evil spirit in your life. And so we all have different reference points in life, but the source of all our woes is simply sin. And the story that we are coming to study, Noah, how God was so gracious to him, though he was living in a very wicked and corrupt world in his day. The gospel tells us that Jesus Christ sets us free from sin and its effect. Luke chapter 4, verse 18 and 19, Christ said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has sent me to preach good news to the poor, recovery of sight to those who I do not see, and also to set our prisoners free. So we all have different reference points. And as we prepare to celebrate our 15th anniversary, the question is, where did God take you from? If you forget that, pride will set in and you may not even have the conviction to praise the living God. And there are many of you who have not responded to the grace of God yet, but this afternoon's sermon, I'm sure, is going to help all of us to sit up well. So this sermon tells us how God redeemed Noah from sin, darkness, and wickedness. It tells Noah's response to God's grace and how God gave him and the rest of humanity in a new context, a covenant, and a new life. The same grace has appeared to all men, Titus 2:11 to 15 tells us. And now your response is to your role is to respond to God's kindness. And many of you have responded to God's grace. And you can see God's grace working in your life. And it's my prayer this afternoon that may the Lord move you from grace to grace. Grace is God's favoring a person. That's the meaning of grace. That is God's unmerited favor that he bestows upon a person or a group of people. Redemption, on the other hand, is an act of God setting people free from everything contrary to his plan for humanity. So sin, darkness, slavery, poverty, addiction, condemnation, sicknesses, barrenness, you name them. So that is redemption. The Israelites were redeemed from slavery. Paul was redeemed from blasphemy. He disrespected the things of God in Christ. He wanted to destroy the church. And many were redeemed from evil possession. And many were healed in the name of Christ. The blind received their sight. And many thousands, if not millions, had the good news about the kingdom of God. Christ set us free. And these three things, they all work together. Grace, redemption, and new life. And our response is to thank the Almighty God. So your part is to respond to God's grace. And as we'll be looking at, the grace of God tells you what to do. And as you obey, you are redeemed unto a new life. And once you have the new life, you must not thank God for such a great redemption. Give yourself fully to God. All that God has been to other people, he's ready to be to you as well. We've mentioned some patriarchs and some godly men and women as name in the Bible. And just as the Lord was with them, he's ready to be with you. Like he was with Abraham, he was with Isaac, he was with Jacob, and he's ready to be with you if you will submit your life to him this very day. Jesus referred to the story of Noah in the book of Matthew chapter 24. And he said, before his second coming, the conditions in the world will be like the days of Noah before the flood. And so that is the passage we'll be using to discuss today's sermon, that our thanksgiving is part of our redemption story. And what God redeemed you from is always your reference point in life. If you forget about that, you become unhinged. You don't really have that strong conviction to thank the Lord. It could also be that you have not indeed been redeemed. If you don't remember your reference point, means either you've not been redeemed or you are being ungrateful, or because you have not been celebrating thanksgiving to God, you have forgotten. So the Lord told his people in the Old Testament to always remember to thank him. So let's read the book of Ephesians 1:3 to 10. Then we come to our main text at the book of Genesis 6. So Ephesians 1:3 to 10 says, praise be, please open your Bibles and let's read together, right? So we are not rushing to finish. We want to really enjoy God this afternoon. Ephesians 1, praise be to God our Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessings in Christ. So he thanked the Lord. He thanked God for all the blessings. And one of the other things he mentioned was that, verse 6, say, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In 7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Okay, so redemption, praise, thanksgiving to God, and that new life that God gives us, they go hand in hand. And as I said, our focus should be on the life of Noah, so that we will learn how practically these three great themes played out in his life. Noah, the book of Genesis 6, let's read from the verse 5 to verse 8. It talks about how God was very gracious to Noah. And I pray that may you receive the same grace this very, very afternoon. It said, the Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thought of the human heart was only evil all the time. The Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. So the Lord said, I will wipe from the face of the earth the human race I have created, and with them the animals, the birds, and the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I have made them. Verse 8, but Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. So God sees everything. He is the owner of the world. And as we become very corrupt and wicked, he regrets for making us, for bringing us into his world. In the days of Noah, that was the situation. But the verse 8 says that Noah found favor, the grace of the Lord, single Noah out because what? He purposed in his heart to really serve the Lord. So the grace will come, but you must respond to the grace of God. Abraham received the same grace in Genesis chapter 12. We've mentioned Paul of Tarsus, and the book of Titus 2:11-15 tells us the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. And it teaches us to say no to ungodliness and to live a pure, holy life as we wait for the glorious appearance of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Grace will teach you what to do. So those who go with this, I believe that we are under grace, hence they live anyhow. What happens is that they deceive themselves, because grace teaches us what to do, right? Grace teaches us what to do. Now let's go back and continue from verse 11-17 in the book of Genesis 6:11-17. So the verse 8 says, but Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Okay, so see verse 11. It repeats the context, the situation of the world at that time. 11 says, now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. And God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. And God saw everything. When people reject God, thinking that then it doesn't matter how they live, they deceive themselves. Whatever you do, God sees. God saw the corrupted ways of the people. 13 says, so God said to Noah, listen carefully. Verse 13. So God said to Noah, I'm going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I'm surely going to destroy both them and the earth. 14. So make yourself an ark of cypress wood. Make rooms in it and coat it with pitch inside and out. This is how you are to build it. Listen, the grace came on Noah. God was telling him out of the grace what to do. Build an ark. Noah, build an ark. I'm coming to destroy the world. Build an ark. So when he jumped to verse 22, it says Noah did everything just as God commanded. And this is where most Christians fail. The grace has appeared. It will tell you what to do. And now in the New Testament, the grace that saves us tells us to put our faith in Christ Jesus, repent from our sins, and be baptized and live as a child of God. Obey God and live a holy life and win souls and help other people and stay away from evil and sin and corrupted ways. That is what the grace of God that brings salvation teaches us. Now, when the grace of God appears to you so that you, for example, have a child, that same grace will teach you what to do. So when you read the book of Judges, I think chapter 13, when the angel of the Lord appeared to Samson's mother and father and promised them that child Samson, later on the woman ran and went to the angel of the Lord and said, but you did not tell me how I should raise up this child. Okay, that was a very wise woman. The grace of God teaches you what to do. Now God told Noah, hey, build an ark, I'm coming to destroy the world, but I'll save you and your people. Build it up. Now, if you don't build it, it means that you've not responded to my grace. And those of you who are listening, if you have not put your faith in Jesus Christ, if you have not repented from your sins, if you have not been baptized and you are not living as a child of God, you have not still responded to the grace of God, although the grace has appeared to you. And Revelation 3:20 tells us that Christ speaks to the church and says, I stand at the door and knock, that if you hear my voice, I will come in to come and dine with you. The grace has appeared, but the problem has always been that people don't listen to the grace. Noah was told, build an ark. God says, I'm coming to destroy the world. Build an ark. And verse 22 says, Noah did everything God told him. Let's look at God's power over creation. And then we'll continue to look at the fact that human effort in our redemption makes the work very difficult. So redemption is entirely the work of God. All we have to do is to stay within the confines, the parameters that God has given us. Noah was told to build an ark. In the New Testament, we are told to put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, repent from our sins and evil deeds, be baptized, and live a godly life as God's children. If you add to this, you make it so complicated. If you subtract it, you even end up being flooded and perished with the ungodly citizens. The power of God over creation, over evil, over Satan, over everything. And then we'll come to the fact that truly creation, redemption is the work of God. So let's move to chapter 7, and then we'll read a few verses there, then we'll move to chapter 8, the same Genesis. So let's go to chapter 7. And so 7 verse 1 says, the Lord God said to Noah, go into the ark, you and your whole family, because I have found you righteous in your generation. Right. And so, I mean, when I was studying this last night, I was like, wow, that is how we should live. We should aspire to be righteous in our generation. Isn't that beautiful? Because you see, when we die, we'll leave everything. We'll leave everything. What matters is our relationship with the Almighty God. And if God could give such a wonderful testimony about Noah, I'm sure that it was a great achievement. Verse 2 says that, take with you 7 pairs of every kind of clean animal, male and its mate, 1 pair of every kind of unclean animal, male and its mate, and also 7 pairs of every kind of bird, male and female, to keep their various kinds alive throughout the earth. 7 days from now, I will send rain on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and I will wipe from the face of the earth every living creature I have made. 5. And Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. Beautiful. Noah did everything that the Lord commanded. Verse 24 says that the waters flooded the earth for 150 years. Now, when God is redeeming, right, at the same time, He is condemning some things. When God is redeeming you from Pharaoh, He has to condemn Pharaoh. When God is setting you free, He must condemn the one who is holding you captive. When God is blessing you, anything, if it is sin, the sin must be atoned for through the sacrifices of Christ. So anytime you are being set free, know that someone, some spirit, something is being condemned. When the Israelites passed through the Red Sea, the Egyptians were drowned. Anytime you are being set free, someone is receiving condemnation. So that is why sometimes our redemption takes a long time, because whoever is responsible for your downfall, your woe, your pain, God gives the person enough time to repent. So in the case of Pharaoh, God gave him a long time to repent. In the case of Noah, it took him 120 years to build the ark. God was giving the people time. His kindness was even towards the people, but only Noah received it. So we jump to verse chapter 8 verse 1, and it reads that after the earth had been flooded, God now remembered Noah. Okay, so we see God's redemptive act, saving Noah, condemning others. Chapter 8, 10 to chapter 8 verse 1. But God remembered Noah, and may the Lord remember you. And all the wild animals and the livestock that were with him in the ark. And he sent a wind over the earth, and the waters receded. Redemption is of the Lord. So he sent wind, and the waters receded. Now the springs of the deep and the floodgates of heavens had been closed, and the rain had stopped falling from the sky. The water receded steadily from the earth. At the end of the 150 days, the water had gone down. And on the 17th day of the 7th month, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. The waters continued to recede until the 10th month. And on the first day of the 10th month, the tops of the mountains became visible. When God wants to save you, it is entirely His gracious act. He did everything. So through Christ in the New Testament, He sent Christ to die for our sins. We had no clue how Christ died, the agony, the pain that He went through. But the Father sustained Him and He died and rose again for the forgiveness of sins. Redemption is entirely the work of God. Now anytime I read a passages like this, it just builds my faith up to trust in God and be so confident that I have a great God who sees all and is all powerful, and even nature even submits to Him, and at His words, things are done or undone. Now it's very interesting that Noah now tried to play a role in God's redemptive work. He cannot do anything. When the disciples tried to be with Christ, even during His trial and suffering, you know, when Christ was denied of justice, I think even the trial did not start, and Peter and all the 12, deserted Christ. No one was there. And that's very interesting that here, and Noah wanted to be part of that redemptive story. All that he had to do was obey God and stay within the parameters he was given to operate. So we will continue from verse 6 to 14 and see Noah trying to do something. But my brothers and sisters, salvation is always of the Lord. It is not from us. We receive it by faith, and then it continues that way. So human effort in our redemption makes the work very difficult. Noah tried to find out when to come out of the ark by examining the weather when he sent the doves and the animals. So he said, go and check if outside is good so that they have the go out. But my friend, if God shuts the door, no one can open. It's very interesting that when you read chapter 7, verse 16, right? Chapter 7, verse 16, let me read up to you. It says, the animals going in were male and female, every living thing, as God had commanded Noah, going to the ark. Then the Lord shut him in. So it was the Lord who sealed the ark. He sealed it. And Noah and the animals could not come out. He stayed in there until the judgment is over. And I think believers must learn how to stay in and trust the Lord. When the Lord shuts the door, don't try to open, stay in. Human effort in our redemption makes the work very difficult. So let's continue from chapter 8, verse 6 to 14. Here we see Noah trying to do things, and even the animals were not so pleased with him. Chapter 8, verse 6. After 40 days, Noah opened a window he had made in the ark and sent out a raven, and it kept flying back and forth until the water had dried up from the earth. So he was just troubling this animal, going round and round. If you're a pastor and you cannot hear from God, right, you just confuse your members. You give them any assignment and they become frustrated. And Noah had not heard from the Lord all this while, and he sent an animal, go and check if outside is good. And the animal was in trouble, going forth and back. Okay, a lot of people are frustrated because they don't have a clear direction from the Almighty God. It said, then he sent out a dove to see if the water had receded from the surface of the earth. So so the first animal stayed there until everything dried up. Then he sent a dove, which I thought was a bit wiser and clean. 9. But the dove could not find anywhere to perch because there was water over all the surface of the earth. So it returned to Noah in the ark. The first one, I think, didn't come back. I'm sure the animal perished or something. But the dove was wise. He came back. See, all Noah had to do was to wait for God to speak. But let's read on. He reached out his hand and took the dove and brought it back to himself in the ark. 10. He waited 7 more days and again sent out the dove from the ark. Then when the dove returned to him in the evening, there in its peak was a freshly plucked olive leaf. Then Noah knew that the water had receded from the earth. He waited 7 more days and sent the dove out again. But this time it did not return to him. I'm sure when the dove realized that the outside was cool, he said, let me just go my way and then leave this nowhere alone who is trying to disturb me. So the animal did not come back. I'm sure he was tired. But very interesting here. Now, verse 14 says, by the first year of the first month, Noah's 601st year, the water had dried up from the earth. Noah then removed the covering from the ark and saw that the surface of the ground was dry. By the 27th day of the second month, the earth was completely dry. But he could not come out. But God shut the ark, sealed the ark. And as the Lord opens the door for you, he cannot do much. You wait on the Lord until he opens it. Verse 15 says, then God said to Noah, come out of the ark, and your wife, you and your wife, your sons and their wives. Bring out every kind of living creature that is with you, the birds, the animals, and all the creatures that move along the ground, so they can multiply on the earth and be fruitful and increase in number on it. When God speaks, things are not right. And that was what Noah should have done, waited on the Lord. Psalm 110 verse 1 says that the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make all your enemies your footstool. There are times you have to learn to sit, especially when you are becoming frustrated. Doors are not opening, things are not going the way you want, like Noah. You don't need to be wasting your strength. Wait on the Lord. When God spoke, Noah, come out. It was done. It was the Lord who shut it. I mean, who shut the door to the ark. He sealed it. Other translation will say he sealed the ark. So he said, Noah, you cannot come out. It means that he opened the ark. And so they all came out. 18 says, so Noah came out together with his sons and his wife. And his son's wife, all the animals and all the creatures that move along the ground, and all the birds, everything that moves on the land came out of the ark, one kind after the other. The 20 to 22, verse 20 to 20 is quite a very interesting theme, which we've already established that when we give thanks to God, he adds more blessings to us. Okay, very important. We established this last week, Sunday. I think the text was from Luke 19:11-17, where we said that when we thank the Lord, indeed, he adds more blessings to us. So we've also established this fact that we can add nothing to God's redemptive act. Don't do it. You waste your time. And Noah tried it, but it didn't work. But at the right time, God spoke for them to come out. When he knew that the outside was safe for them. So be patient if God is hidden from you. Or if God is hidden harm from you. Learn to sit at the right hand of God until he makes all your enemy your footstool. If Noah had come out himself, he had done that, he would have perished. So wait on the Lord. It's not easy. He was there for days and days and months and months. Yes. I prefer to wait on the Lord than to go out there and perish because I don't even know the conditions out there. My God knows. So we are now focusing on the verse 20 to 22. Thanksgiving to God leads to more blessings. After Noah made sacrifice to God, God bless him more. God bless him more. God bless him more. So we now look at verse 20 to 22. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and taking some of all the clean animals and clean birds, he sacrificed burnt offerings on it. That was a key thing. Such a great redemption, right? What do? You thank God. And the thanksgiving is part of the redemption story. So now, at least we've seen three themes here. Grace, redemption, thanksgiving, and then God will give them a new life. Noah thanked God. Verse 21 says, the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma and said in his heart, never again will I curse the ground because of human beings, even though every inclination of the human heart is evil from childhood. And never again will I destroy all living creatures as I have done. I keep saying that when it comes to obedience, one person's obedience can give all of us life. And obedience of Christ to God gave all of us salvation. And when Noah obeyed God, the human race was preserved. I challenge you during this Thanksgiving season, purpose in your heart to obey the Almighty God. Because of your obedience, a family member, your family will survive. Because of your obedience, your children will do well in life. Because of your obedience, the church of God will grow from strength to strength. Because of your obedience, someone will have good life. Because of your obedience, someone will be saved. Noah obeyed God. And the whole of the human race was preserved through him. And then look at the words of our Lord. Having smelled the pleasing aroma, he said in his heart, never again will I curse the ground because of human beings, even though every inclination of the human heart is evil from childhood. And never again will I destroy all living creatures as I have done. And then he gave this solemn oath. He said, as long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. When we thank God, it opens more doors for blessings for us. And Noah made a sacrifice. I think on Friday we studied the three types of Thanksgiving. We have the personal Thanksgiving because you have the bread of life. We took that from Psalm 150 verse 6. We also mentioned the Thanksgiving that we must offer to God because we are part of his creation and he has made us wonderfully and beautiful. And so we look at yourself, we look at the power of God throughout the universe, and the right thing to do is to thank him and to worship. And then we also look at the prescriptive Thanksgiving, that is the Thanksgiving God teaches us because we are now his chosen people, which I think we'll be looking at this a bit more later. Noah offered a wonderful sacrifice to the Almighty God, and I'll encourage you on a Thanksgiving day, fill your heart with love and blessings and go to the house of the Lord and offer wonderful sacrifice to the Lord. In the New Testament, the Lord demands a bit more from us. We don't just offer material things, we offer our lives, our body, spirit, and soul. The book of Romans 12:1, it says, in view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice to the Lord. For this is your spiritual act of worship. When God saves you from sin, from darkness, from poverty, from witchcraft, from sorcery, from divination, from barrenness, from disgrace, as a result of the effect of sin, the right thing is to thank him. And the New Testament is not just material things, but we give our lives. Because then God wants to come and live in us. Then our bodies become the temple of the Holy Spirit of God. As long as yet, and your seed and harvest time, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night, whatever. Because of one person's disobedience to God, Noah obeyed God, and God retained this covenant that he instituted in the creation to preserve it. Let's go to chapter 9, and then we see a bit more there. That thanksgiving to God opens a new life. Now, Noah has a new life without all those wicked men and women who had corrupted themselves and the world and their created order. Noah had a new life. When Christ redeems us, he gives us new life. As 2 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone is in Christ, it's a new creation. The old has passed, the new has come. We are a new creation. We are new life, and so then we must now live the way that God wants us to live, which, again, that is where most Christians fail. When they receive the grace of God, they want to live anyhow. They keep saying, we are under grace, we are under grace, we are saved by faith. But they forget that the grace teaches us what to do. The faith in the Lord Jesus also teaches us what to do. It is not something mystical, it's not something abstract, it's not just philosophical saying that we retain that belief in our head. It teaches us how to live until we are called to the paradise of God. Stay away from sin, obey the Lord's commandment. So there are a lot of Christians, they continue to plunge themselves into sin and ruin because when they receive their grace, they don't want to live their new life of holiness and righteousness and peace and worshiping God and winning souls and helping other people and staying away from the things of the world. And so they hurt themselves and God's heart beats. As we read in Genesis 6, God was so sad that his own creation had become very Genesis chapter 9, verse 1. Then God blessed Noah and his sons, saying to them, so you need the blessings of God. Okay, the grace will come, but you need the blessings. As you respond to the grace, right, it tells you what to do. And as you show gratitude, you thank God. And that's how the blessings come. Where we studied last week, Christ said to that leper who was healed, he said, your faith has made you well. That is the blessings of the Lord. Your faith. He came back and thanked God and praised God, denied it not. A lot of Christians, once God blessed them, that's it. They move on, they leave God, they leave the church, and the blessing won't go far. So in the Old Testament, God taught the people that when they get to the promised land, always observe these Thanksgiving, you know, celebrations to me. Because the moment we become ungrateful, I think we cease to be, you know, the normal human being created in the image of God. God blessed Noah and his sons, saying to them, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. Be fruitful. The fear and the dread of you will fall on all the beasts of the earth, and all the birds in the sky, on every creature that moves along the ground, and all the fish in the sea, they are given into your hands. So again, man had dominion over every living thing. Okay, this earth is ours, it's our realm, and we have the spirits are not supposed to come and interact with us. But Satan, as a fallen angel and with his demons, they are part of our universe. Sorry, our world, this earth. So God gives us dominion over animals. You don't have dominion over your fellow human being. We don't do that. That is a witchcraft thing. Anytime you want to have dominion over your fellow human being, that's witchcraft. You are to love your fellow human being, because that man, that woman, was created in the image of God. And you all look like God in character-wise. So wherever there is oppression and slavery and injustice, God is angry at those who do that. God gave them and gave them all the green plants. Verse 4 says, but you must not eat meat that has its lifeblood in it. Okay, so then you listen to God's commandment. That is, again, Christians fail here. That same grace will lead you home. But that same grace will continue to teach you how to live. So you can eat animal meat, but don't eat the animal while the blood is still in it. Don't do that. 5. And for your lifeblood, I will surely demand an accounting. I will demand an accounting from every animal. And from each human being too. I will demand an accounting for the life of another human being. If you take someone's life, and it explains here, 6. Whoever sheds human blood, by human shall their blood be shed. For in the image of God has God made mankind. So human beings, we are very precious to God. And even the animals, you don't just kill and eat. You must kill in the right way. You must make sure that you pour out the blood. And you only eat the flesh. Because the blood of the animal is the life of the animal. And that life belongs to God. Your life belongs to God. My life belongs to God. That's why he would demand an accounting. We all stand before God to give an account. Whatever thing we did in this world, whether good or bad, he would demand an accounting from us. 7. As for you, be fruitful and increase in number. Multiply on the earth and increase upon it. God now pronouncing blessings upon them. The Lord was giving them a new life. Just imagine that the millions of people who were all perished, now you are only 8 people on the surface of the earth, and God is proclaiming this good news to you, that fill the earth. Fill the earth. When we come to the Christ, it's the same way. We come and we are made anew, and he gives us a new life to bear fruit of righteousness, of holiness, of kindness and goodness, so that the earth will be filled with the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. And a Christian that has not bear fruit has fallen short of the glory of God. So fill the earth and increase it. 8. Then God said to Noah and his sons with them, and now establish my covenant with you and your descendants after you. So now their new life was established within the context of the covenant and agreement. And so in Christ Jesus, we also have that new Testament covenant through the blood of Christ. We also come into covenant. So it is not just a new life that is not protected, but it's a new life that is protected and sealed by the Almighty God himself. He gave the same to Abraham, and when he could not get anything greater than himself, he sweared himself and said, Abraham, I swear by myself, Genesis chapter 2, that I will bless you. God always works within the context of covenants, agreement. So you take time to study the terms of the agreement, just obey, and that will become your righteousness. The New Testament is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And God's last word to humanity. The book of Hebrews tells us. So he said that I now establish my covenant between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and a rainbow appears in the cloud, I'll remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. So we have this assurance that no matter how many days, weeks, and months it rains, God will never destroy the earth with water. But we don't know about fire yet. So it's likely that he will destroy the world with fire, which that's what the scripture seems to tell us. 16, whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth. In the Old Testament, Moses' covenant with God for the Israelites was through, you know, the Passover lamb, Exodus 12. So, well, wherever I see the blood, I'll pass over. And the New Testament, Christ is our Passover lamb. And as we put our faith in him and receive him as Lord and Savior, the Messiah, he marks us with his blood and seals us with the Holy Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. But here in creation, God gave us the covenant, that rainbow. That anytime we see the rainbow, it should remind us of God's covenant with us and all living creatures that water will never be used to destroy us. 17 says, so God said to Noah, this is the sign of the covenant I have made, have established between me and all life on this earth. Now the verse 18 down tells us about the sons of Noah. Then it continues. This is just a very beautiful and a very yet simple thing, that thanksgiving to God leads to more blessings. When Noah made sacrifices to God, God blessed him more. In the same way, Christ pronounced further blessings upon the man who was healed and returned to give praise to God. And thanksgiving is part of our redemption story. Where did God take you from? What lifestyle? What that unpleasant situation? And don't forget that situation is as a result of sin, right? So sin and its consequences bring suffering upon us. And some people, sin will manifest in their lives as sickness, others as barrenness, others as poverty, others as slavery. The Israelites were slaves in Egypt because of the sins of Pharaoh, injustice. And God took them from the hands of Pharaoh. I pray that may you receive God's grace and learn to walk in grace, because the grace will tell you what to do. Many Christians are confused because they've heard the grace, but they are not following the teachings of the grace. The grace will tell you to move away from sin and to live a pure life and serve the Lord, you know, like the New Testament will teach us. Our sermon, so the new life, we have mentioned that Genesis 9, 1 to 17. So increase in number, live in peace. Live a holy life, worship God. And God told them, and that was in the context of a protected arrangement, covenant. And he used the rainbow to seal it. And in Christ Jesus, the Lord seals us with his Holy Spirit as special people dedicated to the Lord. Our topic is very simple, that our thanksgiving to God is part of our redemption story. And David was a shepherd boy, despised, and God took him to become a king. So David had that as his reference point. And Saul of Tarsus was a persecutor, a blasphemer, and that was his reference point. Mary Magdalene had demons in her, and when the Lord Jesus set her free, that was her reference point. And you and I, we have also suffered the consequences of sin in many ways. Some of you sickness, some of you wayward lust, some of you addiction, some of you sexual immorality, some of you theft, some of you arrogance and all sort of life. But through Christ Jesus, we are redeemed. We are redeemed into a new life. And our task is to thank the Lord. So the sermon has been very simple. That it tells us how God redeemed Noah from sin, wickedness, darkness. And it also tells us Noah's response to God. God said, Noah, you have found favor. But that favor tells you something. Build an ark and go into it. Noah obeyed. And God gave Noah new life when he was redeemed. And Noah thanked God. And God bless him so much. So it's my prayer that those of you who have received the grace of the Lord, you continue to walk in that grace. You know, and that hymn says that it was grace that taught my heart to fear. And that, you know, the grace that saved me, that same grace will lead me home. That grace that appeared, that warmed your heart, that pricked your heart, that helped you to love Christ, that gave you the new breath. Continue to walk in that grace. And that same grace will lead you home. And out of this context, my brothers and sisters, we thank the Almighty God. Daily and on special occasions, and as a church, once a year we have a Thanksgiving Sunday. And this year, 2020, marks our 15th anniversary since the church I was established here in London, UK. And so on the 13th of the day should have been today, 29th of November, but because of the lockdown restrictions, we'll be doing that in 2 weeks' time. And London is in tier 2, and so we are allowed to go to church, but again, observe social distances and all the COVID protocols. So we will do a very simple, short service, thanking God, and we will go home. And I think we'll be launching our Jubilee Fund again to help the poor and the needy, because all of us at some point we were poor and needy. That the grace of God has helped all of us, and the grace of God will continue to sustain us. So this is our sermon this afternoon. Grace, redemption, new life, and thanksgiving to God. The story of Noah. Let me say hello to the few people online as we send to run, God willing, from the second, we will go back to church. Second is, I think, it's a Wednesday. So on Friday, there'll be service 7 to 8:30. And then even then on Sunday, there'll be service. I think we have some child educations on the 6th. We also have child educations on the 13th. We have child educations on the 20th. And I think there's one coming up on 27th. I think the weddings will be postponed to the following year. And then hopefully after our COVID, our restrictions are lifted. So we do have baptisms as well. But because of COVID, we are still planning how to go about it in a very secure and safe way so that we will not help spread a virus. So let me say hello to the few people online this very afternoon. Let me say hello to the few people. As usual, through this, we exchange greetings. So we can see Frankie Fletcher, George Miracu, Yeboa, Sam Ann, all watching with us. We can see V Nana. I mean, you said Bishop V Nana. I tried to send me a text message so that we will know your real name. V Nana, send me a text message so that we know your real name. I'm sure you have my number. If not, you can ask for it. Then we have Sam Ann saying amen, God bless you, Sam. Then we have Sharon Smith saying God bless you. We have Paulina Mills saying God bless you. Regina Kwako say God bless you. And Joanne saying amen. And Frankie Fletcher saying God bless you. We have Rocky And Lydia saying, amen. We have Chain for Christ. Brother Robert saying, amen. And we have V, Nana, okay, and I know you, also saying, amen. We have Yasmin in Japan saying, amen. Greetings from the Japan family. We have Masakumba, that is Fatimata and the husband, Cecil, and all the children saying, amen. Sending God's blessings. Then Amma and Ima saying, grace will teach you what to do until the Lord opens the door for you. You can't do much. When God speaks, things are done right. Learn to sit and wait. Give thanks to God. He will open more doors and add more blessings to your life. That's a very good a summary of some of the things that we have said. And Vinana says it's very good. I mean, and we can see Winifred, Amelia Boateng, saying God bless you, Winifred. And we can see Lorraine from Eastham. God bless you, Lorraine, my neighbor. She's now my neighbor. And we can see UK Sowa Edward saying God bless. We can see Faith Parsons. God bless you. Faith, yeah, we need to be in touch soon. We can see Johnny Johnson saying Amy from the Johnsons. I'm sure from Stacy as well. I can see Jay Bright say, I mean, greetings to everyone. I understand it was you guys, your fourth anniversary. God bless you guys. And then Chain for Christ also saying, God bless you, Bishop, for that great message. And so I can only see few people here. And yeah, we can also hear from Brother Adote Jr. And the wife, Amma Adote Jr. saying, God bless you, Bishop. So I leave you with God's blessings this afternoon. And I know best it was your birthday yesterday. I wish you a happy birthday. God's blessings, greetings to everyone. And yeah, so I'll leave you to have a very good a Sunday afternoon, you know, as usual, unless you are fasting. If you are not fasting, try to have a very good lunch and dinner and just relax. And if you want to visit friends and family members, go ahead. That is if it's allowed to go out. If not, stay at home. But have a good time in the presence of the Lord. And may the Lord bless you this coming week. The working week starts tomorrow. May the Lord keep you safe. And may the Lord move you from grace to grace. But more importantly, fill your heart with joy. And those who have not given their lives to Christ, give your life to Jesus. Respond to the grace and allow the grace of God to continue to teach you until he leads you home to his paradise. God bless you. Amen. Amen.